Attention. Welcome to the Different Spectrums podcast. We dive into the wild world of mental health discussions. Get ready for profound talks, a sprinkle of humor and sarcasm, and a touch of colorful language. Just a quick heads up, our show reflects our individual opinions, which may not align with the standpoint of the podcast, our featured guests, or any related corporate entities. Our mission? To illuminate through laughter and satire, because everyone needs a good chuckle. Chill out and don't stress over the small stuff. Legal troubles? No thank you. Cancel culture? Please spare us. We'd rather keep this space lawsuit free. So buckle up, have a good time, and join us as we navigate the vibrant realm of mental health on the Different Spectrums podcast. Today's episode is sponsored by BetterHelp. BetterHelp connects you with a licensed therapist who is trained to listen and give you helpful, unbiased advice. By using our link, you can get 10% off your first month of therapy. So, Naz, as a therapist on BetterHelp, what has your experience been like?
I've been doing it since January of 2021, and it's been really fun and exciting. I've been able to reach clients all over the United States and the world. I've had good relationships. I've had folks that I've had for a couple months and a good handful where I've had for almost 2 years now. So it's magnificent. I've enjoyed my time and my clients. I love them.
Awesome. You can do it all from your phone or computer via phone call, video chat, or messaging, however you feel the most comfortable. Let BetterHelp connect you to a therapist who can support you all from the comfort of your own home. Visit betterhelp.com/DSP or choose Different Spectrums Podcast during sign up and enjoy a special discount on your first month. Everyone watch your ears. Sorry. So hey everybody, we back again.
Hey, we're back, we're live.
I'm Spencer, of course. That's our licensed clinical therapist, Naz.
Dr. Naz. New company founder, Different Spectrums Co. Nonprofit. We ain't got no money because we're nonprofit.
Yep, that's how it works. remember, don't take us too seriously.
Or do. It's completely up to you, jackass.
Also, okay. All right. Don't forget to ramp those likes for us. We'd really appreciate it. So before we get into it, we have a special guest today. Our guest is a documentary filmmaker and recent Emmy nominee. After 5 years in film development at Columbia Pictures and 5 years working at Simon Cowell's SYCO production company, our guest decided to focus on stories exploring the human experience, humanity, spirituality, and social issues. He is the producer and director of the award-winning documentary Everybody Dance, which is currently on iTunes, Apple TV, and free on Amazon Prime. He was also producer on the award-winning film The Center, Gibbons and Guardians, featuring Jane Goodall. He is also currently in production for a documentary series titled Women of Dance and an untitled documentary with Tony and Pulitzer Prize winning producer Daryl Roth. Please welcome Dan Watt to the show.
Hi, guys. It's great to be here. Thanks so much for having me.
Good to have you, Dan. Yeah. You've been a hoot so far on the pre-production. A hoot. That's what we like to say here. A hoot. that's not a racial slur, so don't worry about it. All right, so.
What race are we slurring there? Jesus. You can't say nothing these days. Fucking Democrats. I swear to God, I'm joking. Completely joking.
Sure, buddy. Sure. We'll be speaking about the RNC right now. Before we get into all that, today's topic and film that we are covering is Dan Watt's film, Everybody Dance.
Yes, sir.
So a few things that we're going to be covering today, just different types of learning, families and how they deal with autism, some of the signs and symptoms of autism, as well as kind of the talents and gifts that they may have, as well as how they are being bullied in school. And how, you know, just being different, kind of creates that animosity for people to bully them even further.
Yeah. So with that, Nas, anything before we get into the show?
I think I'm pretty excited to get into this. You know, Dan hit us up, and you know, I put him off for a little bit because, you know, my ADHD got in the way. And I was like, I'm gonna watch it, man. I'm gonna watch it. And then we went on vacation and he's like, you watch it yet? I'm like, motherfucker, I'm gonna get to it. I'm gonna get to it. And then finally I was like, man, let me just send Dan the damn calendar invite and then I'm gonna watch it. And it's interesting because like soon as we booked him, I saw another documentary right before I even watched his, because they made us watch it at work about autism. And now that director and producer is coming on. So like, it's kind of cool to like both of these films focus on abilities, differing abilities, autism. And I think it's just a blessing to get to these films, bro. And to like mm-hmm. real life stories and to look some real humans instead of just like the, you know, the fiction that we deal with most of the time, me and Spencer. So excited about today. We're going to talk about a lot of things we've talked about in the past, symptoms, you know, what people say. There's some slurry things that other people happen to the parents in there. We're going to probably get into that. It depends. Y'all know, you know, it's one of them. See what happens. So I'm really excited. Let's get into it. Let's have some fun. It looks like Dan's crazy as shit. So,
that's a good thing.
What gave you that idea?
Yeah.
What?
Yeah, I don't know. So we're going to have some fun, folks. All right. Let's do it. Whoop, whoop.
There you go. Whoop, whoop.
Come on, Dan. Give it to me, Pappy.
What am I doing?
Just whoop, whoop.
Whoop. Oh, whoop, whoop.
Whoop, whoop.
There you go. Got a little flair onto it.
Yeah, a little sugar on it, huh?
A little sugar.
Buzz, let me stop.
All right, oh my god.
Oh man. All right, we're done.
Look first. Good job. Open and close and open and close. I had my sister, Cindy, who's a classical pianist and just very, very talented, compose all the music for the classes. Let me see it. So I'm teaching auditorily. See it. Boop. I'm teaching visually. Yes, gorgeous. And then kinesthetically, using props, using things like that. So it'd be really easier to show you. So an échappé, right? Is essentially just an opening and a closing of the feet, right? Jump, jump closed, jump open, jump closed, jump first. Yeah, so most ballet classes, they'll say, be like a pair of scissors, jump open and close. And again, with somebody with auditory processing, that's not going to fly. But I actually use props where I can show them and be like, open and close, and open and close. And that way they can actually see it. And so for somebody with autism or somebody who learns kinesthetically, this is a really good way to teach them because it's processed in a different way. Jump in your square. Joshua, you're fine. Josh. Thank you. What's up? Okay, we don't need to do that. You're okay, come on. Hands on hips though, love. There you go. Okay, let's see you guys jump. And I think this is what people forget, right? There was a whole human being there with a spirit and an intelligence that's different than my own intelligence, but still as intelligent, just in a different way. Do me a favor, Liam, come down to this side. All right. Okay.
When I had my first interest in ballet, I was in kindergarten. I come out and I say, and I asked Mom, can I take dance lessons? And Mom is, sure. But Mom can put me in a normal dance class. That's why I'm here with Miss Bonnie and Valley Fall Kids. And I also made a lot of friends here.
Good. Down. Good, Liam.
Liam was always very... just a different, unique child. We didn't know what it was. We knew there was something about him, but we just didn't know what it was.
The aversion to making eye contact, the fact that I saw peers able to grasp things, some not even fine motor, but just being able to pick something up and articulate it properly, some of those obvious things.
We couldn't figure it out, and he never wanted to talk about it.
Because I didn't understand it.
But about 2.5, we got concerned about some of Liam's development. So that's when we started going through evaluations to rule in or rule out autism. And they said autism.
I didn't know what to do. I was afraid of it. What does it mean? I was afraid of it, but also it was described that, well, he's not very bad off, and of course I'm thankful for that, but it also made it even harder to understand because there was no, it wasn't as clear cut as I had understood autism to be.
Can you give me the coconut oil, Liam, since you're in there, please?
Here you go.
Thank you, baby.
And then the resources weren't just presented. It took a lot of effort to find something to do. I think a lot more effort than kids who are neurotypical.
Close the microwave.
Okay,
we're gonna cook it for 45 seconds. Time cook.
45.
But after even 6-8 months of ballet for all kids, after getting to the routine of it, he enjoys it, he likes it, and he has a drive to be better at it.
You know, on a genius level of an IQ, or they can have, you know, an intellectual disability, but they need to have certain criteria.
Let's do it again.
Because autism is a spectrum disorder, no two kids really, really look alike when you, you know, so you're like, oh, like people are like, oh, they have autism. Well, what the hell does that mean, right? You have kids with autism that their sensory processing might be, they're really sensitive to touch.
Don't
touch
me.
No, sometimes, Sophia, I'm gonna have to.
So, you and I, right, put on clothing, we might feel the tag on the back of our clothing for 2 seconds, right? And then our body generalizes it and says, okay, that's not important information, right? So we're just gonna let it go. A kid with autism will feel their clothing on 24/7. Now, you're all feeling your clothing right now because I brought it to your attention. So imagine feeling that all the time. You would start to feel itchy, you would start to feel like everything from the elastic to like tags to how it fits, it just would be very hard. You would probably be doing this a lot, right? I might have autism and I might be, touch might be my thing, but you might have autism and it might, your clothing and touch is fine. You love to get snuggled and hugged and all of that kind of stuff.
I like yours too.
Come on, plie.
Your thing might be auditory, right? Where sirens come by and it feels like they're blasting in your ears, so you're going like this, or a toilet flushing in a public bathroom, or me even talking this loud. Or it's just like, oh my gosh, like I'm getting attacked. So how autism is demonstrated and displayed in every kid is different.
Go step back, up, down, up, down. Yes, but. Do we stomp in ballet?
No.
No stomping. Very soft.
Yes.
Okay? All right.
When people say, oh gosh, you know, I know somebody who has autism, they know one person. So they know Liam, who happens to have autism. But Ailey, who also happens to have autism, isn't at all like Liam. So you, just because you know one person with autism means you know just that one person with autism.
Ailey's 6 years old. She is very musical. She has perfect pitch. She can find the pitch on any instrument. She's been in school since she was two and a half, and about 3 days into nursery school, they called and said, we need to talk to you about her progress. And I'm like, you've seen her for a total of 9 hours. What kind of progress could she have made? And they're like, well, just come down. And they introduced me to this notion that she was speech delayed. They sent us to the neuropsychologist, who spent about an hour and a half with us observing her. Ailey stood on a chair and turned the lights on, off, on, off, on, off for 20 minutes. And the lady was kind of like, huh, wow. She's like, Rain Man. And I was like, she just called my kid Rain Man. What? Why would you do that? But she was like, she's brilliant, but I can't, she won't do anything anyone tells her to do. So there's no measuring that. I know that when she was little, she didn't play with other kids. She liked to spin in a circle in the corner and throw things and watch them fall. And she was very ragdoll, like kind of like a bobblehead in her motion. She would fall asleep and her arms would be like this. I think taken individually, these things didn't trigger any alarms, but as a compendium of things, that's basically how we found out that she had autism. She loves dance. I looked everywhere, and Bonnie's class was the only class that actually wasn't just about allowing kids with autism to be in a dance studio and run around wildly to their heart's content, but was about teaching ballet to kids with autism.
Charlie was diagnosed with autism spectrum disorder a little after she turned 3 years old. We knew something was going on leading up to that. She went from being a very joyful baby to a very frustrated toddler. And her she was very smart, exceedingly smart. She could see letters and know what they are in letters and numbers at about 18 months, and she could read words at two. But then her speech was very behind and her social skills were very behind. So we went and got her early intervention, and it was night and day. She just blossomed into this incredibly boisterous and happy and enthusiastic kid.
She has a sticker. But can I ask a question? Do we talk at all when the music's playing?
No.
No, do we make any noise? Do we go,
No. Yes.
No, not when the music's playing. Yes.
I'll be happy.
You'll be happy, but you just smile. No voices. Do you want to help me? You go get my scarves. Come on, you can help me. You can be my little teacher assistant today. Come on.
I wanted to find outlets for all of this enthusiasm. She enjoyed dancing. She wasn't very good at it, but she enjoyed dancing at home. So I thought, hey, ballet would be great. So the occupational therapist at her school recommended ballet for all kids.
You would like yellow? So give her yellow. Okay, and what color would you like, honey?
White.
The white? Okay.
So I called Bonnie, and within a week or so, she was in the class.
Can we lay this down like a magic carpet?
La 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 la.
I have flowers.
It was back in November, she has had an incredible experience so far.
Just our beak. None of our feathers.
I was coming out of practice, and there are a couple steps down to where my scooter was. There's no railing, so I was like, I'll be able to do this. I don't need any help. And so I just stepped incorrectly, rolled my ankle, and ended up fracturing a bone. You know, just disappointing because of the dance.
She's going to do intensive physical therapy.
Yeah.
Recover her, you know, as much as she can by the time that recital comes.
Yeah.
We'll see what we can do, how far she can go. Sarah's always had her mobility problems.
You know, when she was smaller,
I had a slower sense of gravity.
It wasn't as bad when she was smaller, like when she was in elementary school. But even in elementary school,
she wore braces.
Sarah wore braces. She had an aide.
Yeah, full-time aide. Yeah.
So
I had to wear a helmet. Gosh, I hated that.
The kids in your elementary school, unfortunately, were very unsympathetic towards you, and they would. Sarah would be struggling with her little tray at lunch. And I'd see the kids, you know, fill up the bench so that she couldn't sit there. And it was just unkind stuff. Just not really understanding at all, not even trying. It was really, really hard to watch.
Then only became exacerbated as symptoms of Sarah's disability became more and more pronounced. There almost does seem to be like us and the other who is Sarah.
Yeah.
And just combating that is difficult. It's something that you have to consciously make yourself cognizant of.
Most people don't deal with it, that's the thing. It's never going to occur to them, oh, there's a handicapped person here. I've got to take special precautions.
Through years of feeling kind of excluded from certain things, you know, it's just become a fear of mine of being excluded. And I've tried to combat that, but sometimes I feel like, really, yeah, like real, like, no, this is really bothering me to the point of where I'm breaking down.
I mean, the fact that people are not aware is something that's going to happen. So I've always tried to look at it like Sarah, because she's got such a happy spirit, she can teach others to be aware.
We like to put labels on things. It's sort of indicative, right, of our culture and how we are. With kids that are unique or the least bit different, they get these labels, and I think sometimes the labels get internalized and they're not fair. Labels can be very dangerous because if you really look at it, we all have strengths and weaknesses, and we all have abilities and disabilities. We all do. Just some of us are better at hiding it than others. Some of it is just not as obvious. We also all have great abilities. So again, to put people in boxes is frustrating. To say like, oh my gosh, they're disabled. And I want to be like, well, so are you. They're just more self-aware.
Hey everyone, thanks for watching our show today. We just wanted to take some time to give a special shout out to our collaborator, Cat and Raven Design. They are a small queer-owned business that specializes in LGBTQ+ pride soaps. They have great designs, some that even look good to eat, but don't. You can get 10% off your entire order if you use the code DSP or go to our link tree. Help support this great small business and help give back to a great community.
Hey everybody, we back again.
We're back and we're live.
Just as live as the CEO of Grindr that said right now at the RNC, it's the hottest it's ever been active. So much for y'all Christians, you know. So we just as live as Grindr.
We don't condone that. Swipe right.
Damn, he got one of them big ones.
Oh my God.
So. Hey, shout out to all you RNC members that are still in the closet. So,
oh my God. All right. Well, bastards. Thanks for that intro. Yeah. Appreciate you.
Yeah. I just wanted to bring attention to it, the hypocrisy. So,
well, you know, got to on this podcast. Dan, welcome to the show. Would love to know. So, you started off being a performer. And kind of just being kind of, and also a dancer as well.
Okay.
How'd you get into producing?
I'm originally from Cleveland, and I was lucky enough to have an amazing teacher who was from New York. So then I studied in New York, but it was during that Michael Jackson, Janet Jackson, when Janet was just starting that era and that music. So I decided to move to LA because I couldn't sing. So New York didn't really work. You know, that musical theater thing. They're like, oh, you don't sing? I'm like, no. And they're like, well, thank you for showing up. So I moved to LA and started going to auditions. And I actually went to two Janet Jackson auditions a couple months apart, and they didn't watch me dance. And I was like, well, that's weird. I got up at 3 a.m. to leave my house at 5 a.m. to be here at 8 a.m. And all you said was, thank you. So the second time it happened, I waited, and I waited till 10:30 at night till they were walking out. And I went up to one of the ladies that was behind the table, and I said, can you tell me the truth? I want to know why you didn't watch me dance. I said, I've been studying dance. I could do four pirouettes on each leg. What is wrong with you?
Yeah.
You know, she goes, do you want to know the truth? And I said, yeah. And she said, well, you look too much like a man. You look masculine because of your forehead on your chin and your chin. So on film, we're looking for that androgynous asexual. And I'm like, have you met me? You know, like, and they just said on film, it wouldn't translate to what they were looking for. So I had to figure out where to go next because I was still going to stay in the business. So I just started choreographing. And then I started realizing that I could do it better than some of the people doing the production. So I started directing. And then I thought, well, I can do it better than the producer. So I just started producing. So I started producing live theater first. And I've done over probably 75 shows. And then I always wanted to do film and television. So I just took the leap and did it. And nice. Followed my dream. And, you know, I wanted to be a dancer on the Carol Burnett show. But how dare she cancel her show when I was in fifth grade?
What an asshole.
I think you stupid wench, you know. I took it so seriously. I knew height wise I could be the third one from the left.
The third one from the left.
You know how karma works when I moved out here?
Huh.
I studied dance with her daughter, Carrie Hamilton, who was on the TV show Fame. And then Carol hired me to work in her production office.
Oh, well, look at that. Isn't that funny?
I didn't get to be on the show, but I got to work with her after that. Yeah. So awesome. The angels were watching me and, you know, and was like, here, have this instead. Go work in her production office.
All right. That's awesome. Yeah.
Yeah.
Working for the great Carol Burnett. What a legend. So, you know, like I said in the intro, you've been working on production companies for, you know, Columbia. You've been working for them. You've also been working for Simon Cowell as well, right? So how was your transition from doing these big production companies to now being independent?
Well, I was always fascinated with real stories, true stories. And when I was younger, back in Ohio, I would come home from school and I would always watch the Phil Donahue show. It was so interesting to me. And it was him talking to people on stage, real people, for an hour. And my mom would be like, shouldn't you like go out and play? And I'm like, shh, Phil's talking, you know, but I didn't piece that together till later. And I was like, I used to sit and watch Phil Donahue and the Merv Griffin show almost every day. And that played, I think, a big part in what I expected and what I liked. So I always watched documentaries, but I was working on, you know, House Bunny and, I don't even remember all. The House Bunny was the first one where I worked from the table read all the way through.
Okay.
And to do those movies and I'm totally forgetting. What's the one with Tom Hanks in the museum? There was the trilogy.
Ben Stiller. Oh, are you talking about Night at the Museum?
No, the trilogy. Oh, I can't even think about it. Where they go to the Louvre Museum. That whole.
Oh,
are you
talking about the Da Vinci Code?
Yes, or... The Da Vinci Code. The whole lot was turned into that set.
Wow.
So, and, you know, so to be involved with stuff like that, and then Simon poached me to work on the One Direction movie. So I got a step closer to documentaries. And then we followed the band for a year. And I was in the recording studios when they did their first album and all that kind of stuff, filming it. So, and that, but it still wasn't real people to me yet. It was still being manufactured.
Yeah.
So I just felt, it's like every 10 years, my career shifts. You know, I left being a performer to become a stage director, producer, choreographer, and then I left that to go into film and television. And I thought, well, let do what you want. Now, you know, you've been it's been 10 years, and it's I got the itch, and I thought I either have to jump or don't. So I did, and I just decided to find stories that meant something to me that had to me served a higher purpose.
Yep.
In the world, and this is the first one.
There you go. First. And you did all that with that big ass forehead.
Exactly. I hate this screen because how do I do
that? Like, boy, which one is it? The background or my forehead? I can't tell.
That boy got that Peyton Manning head, boy.
Oh my gosh! All right, let's stop okay, roasting let, that let for a second.
Okay, let me. Serious question. Mm-hmm. I forgot what it was. Yeah. Well, you know,
So for real,
how much drugs is on set?
That's for real?
Yeah. Zero?
I didn't see any.
There's no drug. I figured it was zero. It's all done in the trailers.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the movies and the cast that the people that I worked with, I was so lucky to work with, you know, amazing people.
Okay.
You know, Jennifer Aniston's an absolute delight. You know, Adam Sandler is
they say he's awesome.
He's crazy.
Yeah.
But he's very, very, very smart, yep. You know, at what he does. You know, so
who's been one of your favorite people to work with? And if you can say it without getting in trouble, who's been one of your worst people to work with?
You know, I've been very, very lucky. So it depends on what you're talking about. If you're talking about it in the movie in TV business, I have had literally no problem with anyone, but I always told my mom, I'm fucking adorable. I mean, you know, everybody loves me. Why would
it's so true, Dan. It's so true.
Yeah. You know, so a lot of times, because, you know, I can talk to just about anybody, I always got usually placed in that position anyway.
Okay.
Because I can, you know, I don't idolize them. I don't look at them, as a fan.
Yep.
You know, you can appreciate their talent, but I never my job was to take care of whatever needed to be taken care of at that moment. So that was my goal. Okay. So it didn't really, nothing else really, you know, I'll slip it in there. We don't have to talk about it, but I the best person I ever worked for and with was B. Arthur. I was her personal assistant the last 6 years of her life. And she is absolutely hysterical. One of the funniest people you would ever meet.
Okay.
Such a dry sense of humor. And you would just be discussing anything. And then this one liner would come out. She would just spit this joke and you just would lose it. Let me tell you one.
Go ahead.
We're driving down the road. She had fallen in her driveway. They had put pavers down. Her son had redid her driveway and she tripped and fell and hit her head. So she had to get stitches. So she had stitches up here and the only way they could do it was to shave her head. So we had to get her a wig. Well, she wanted to go out to dinner. I'm like, okay, let's go out to dinner. So she has the wig on. We go out to dinner. We eat, blah, blah, blah. The wig is hot. We're in the car. We're driving down the road, San Vicente in California. And she takes her wig off and lays it in her lap. She said, just roll down the window a little bit. We stop at a red light and she looks at me. And then looks down at the wig in her lap. She looks at me again. She goes, does it need a trim? And it's laying right there.
Oh, my God.
How do you respond to that? How do you? You're at the studio, like, you know, and then she's like just waiting for me. You know, she likes to instigate like that. And she just wanted to get how is he going to respond to me pointing to my crotch saying, does it need a trim?
That's hilarious.
You're like, girl, I love a good shrubbery, girl. Oh my
God. You know. Let me tell you, I don't mind deep diving into that.
You know, you got some critters in there. I like some critters, you know. Like Dan already said he had the itch earlier. I'm sorry. We're done with this topic.
Yeah, well, let's move on.
Let's go. Let's go.
All right, Spence, back to you.
One thing on this podcast that we often talk about are the people that really kind of impact our lives, Can you speak to us a little bit about Morgan Spurlock and just how he impacted your documentary?
Yeah, he was the director we hired when I worked for Simon at Psycho Productions for the One Direction movie. And him and I became great friends. And when I was thinking about leaving, you know, when you're under the umbrella of Sony Pictures or Simon Cowell, you know, you're giving up it's a huge decision to make, to leave that security. And I talked to him a lot, and he said, you need to be happy. You need to do what works for you. And he was an independent producer who did, you know, who did documentaries. So he said, either take the leap or don't, you know, but don't you want to be happy? So when I took the leap, he was my right-hand man the entire time. I mean, when I didn't think I could do it, I would text him, and within 5 minutes he would text back and he would say, hey, I can't, how urgent is it? I'm on set. Do you need to talk now or can you wait an hour? I mean, he was that kind to me and that respectful and influential. And since he knew it was my first one, he knew what it took. So he would say, hey, can you wait an hour or do I need to hop on the phone with you now? You know, and he always got back to me. He always had advice. He always had guidance. I could send him clips and he would, you know, I'd send him a scene and he'd go, you know what? Check it one more time. You know, so if I wanted specifics, he would get specific, or he'd say, Dan, give it 2 days and then rewatch it and then let's discuss it. So he was a teacher and a mentor. Yep. And made me make the decisions. Unless I was that stuck and I said, I just really need your help.
He was helping you know? Process. Yeah. That's awesome to help you process.
Exactly. And, you know, to give me permission to sit, you know, sit take 2 days off,
yeah.
Let the files in your brain settle down, let everything settle down. You know, it'll still be there on Monday. You don't have, you're the producer. It's your movie. You don't have to turn it in tomorrow. Ain't nobody asking for it yet. You know? Sure. And to realize stuff like that, I'm very, very lucky to have him by my side, and I miss him a lot.
Yeah. And to be respectful and clear, this was the guy that passed away recently, wasn't it?
Right.
Yep. Yeah. He did the films, Supersize Me, yeah. The greatest movie ever sold. And then, Where in the World is Osama Bin Laden? I actually remember that one. That was a really good one.
Yep.
As an Arab, I'm going to withhold and abstain from that subject. You know, he's still alive. So he's still alive. All right. I respect for you. And then, cause we like to do like a rest in power type of thing for a lot of people that have passed recently. So if you don't mind, we can do that before we get into the scenes of this, just to pay homage to your mentor and someone that you love. If that's something cool, then we'll do that before we get into the scenes. But thanks for sharing that and being vulnerable with us. Appreciate it.
Yes. Thank you. So what made you want to tell the stories of people who are autistic or have disabilities, since they are looked at, you know, as less than for more people? They are, unfortunately. And so what made you want to help tell their stories?
Well, my initial idea was to tell a story about how the arts benefit everyone. That was my big picture. It was, you know, did your mom make you take piano lessons? Did your parents make you take violin or do the summer camp musical theater, but you didn't make a career out of it? How did the arts help you? Was there anything you learned that you apply in your life now? Was my goal. But when I was a dance teacher, now we're talking like 18 years ago, I taught two girls that had autism.
Okay.
And I had a dream about them and their mom, Fran. And I'm like, well, why am I dreaming about Fran and her kids? I'm like, that's weird. You know, I haven't taught in 18 years. And then 2 weeks later, I had a dream about them again. And I also always trust my gut instinct and my higher power or God, whatever you want to call it. And to me, I was being poked. And this was God saying, I'm giving you your movie. This is your way in. I am telling you what to do. You can still get to the message how the arts help everybody, but here's your way in. And I thought, I have to trust this, because it was, you know, it was just so vivid and so clear. So I just went from there. And then I just started researching across the country, looking for conservatories and colleges and dance studios, or, you know, anything. And then I found Bonnie, and it was interesting because I avoided Hollywood, and I looked everywhere except California, because I thought, they're not going to have a school like this in Hollywood. Mm-hmm. They're going to be training dancers to be on, you know, the So You Think You Can Dance and all those award shows. And then to find out it was in my own backyard, it was an hour and a half away from my house after I spent 8 months searching the globe. I mean, searching the country. That was ironic, you know?
Yeah.
And then I met Bonnie, and I told her what my idea was, but she was a little hesitant. Yeah. So we talked, we met probably 6 or 7 times. And then I had to meet with her board of directors of the school. And then we talked to some of the parents, and I just made it very clear to them, because especially with a film with a message like this and a topic like this, I didn't want to exploit them.
Correct.
I wanted them to tell their stories in their words. And I thought, if we approach it as it could be educational to me and anyone else, I felt that was the best way to approach it. And I talked to Morgan about it, and he said, Dan, you're the perfect fit for this. Who else could make this movie? You were a dancer. You choreographed, you've put on shows. Here's a woman who's doing all of that. You will know every aspect of this story, and then you will just learn the personalities of the families and kids. He said, take away that word disability completely and just make a dance movie with those people. Let them just be them. And this is what we got.
There you go. So all full transparency. What me didn't tell you is that when we first, we first came upon you, and you, right, you were talking to us, me and Spencer were hesitant, because we don't want to dive into anything that feels expletive. Like what they call, like, you know, like the trauma porn, they call it, or like this, all right, that different type of slavery movies that they show that just re-traumatizes folks, or what I call disability porn. I didn't want to watch that type of thing. I didn't want to promote that type of thing. Cause I wanted to make sure that, like, these kids are, like, consenting to some of this stuff and, like, having a good ass time and a lot of different things. And so that was Spencer's worry right off the bat. And then I co-signed. I'm like, you're right. I said, I got to watch it first to make sure that this is on the up and up. And then I saw the trailer and I was like, Spence, this might be good. The cinematography is good. And he's like, we still got to watch it, bro, to make sure that we're protecting our people and our listeners. As we know, right, our listeners, right, that are paying attention, a lot are going to be 75-80% women identifying. A lot of them are going to be BIPOC. Most of them are going to be neurodivergent, aka autistic too. A lot of them are going to be queer. And so there's a lot of different intersections and disabilities and abilities in there. And I was like, we got to be cautious. And me and Spence aren't cautious about many things, but when it's our people, we're like, we got to be cautious. So I'm telling you this because we were sus at first, because, you know, it's a new thing, right? It's not our thing, right? The documentaries and film series. And I was like, holy shit, it's pretty good. And yeah. I hate you, Dan, because you got me to cry like 3 fucking times, you piece of shit.
Good. That's the plan.
You even shook me up a little bit with Joshua.
Okay.
Joshua. Oh. I have a very soft spot in my heart for black boys, yeah, with autism, like stuff that, like that, because it's, you know, they're seen very differently in a lot of aspects, and to even be isolated from your own people sometimes is, right, a little tough. So, you know, yeah.
Yep.
And I took that very seriously.
Yeah.
And there's a scene where one of the girls became overwhelmed and she started laughing in class, yep, in the, yep, film, and she left the class. So when she became overwhelmed and, you know, overstimulized, the way she copes is, yeah, she laughs. Well, she also knew that if that happened, just leave the room. And, you know, she leaves the room and she actually hits my cameraman. His camera goes a little shaky. But in my mind, I thought this scene could be a learning tool because we're showing a different aspect of autism.
Yeah.
We're showing a different, you know, just a different person's way of coping. But I wanted to make sure I didn't offend anybody.
Correct.
So I asked the parents and we sat down with the girl and I said, here's the scene. Let's watch it. I will not put it in if you don't want it in. And they watched it and they said, that's our everyday life. And thanks. She loved it because she was being featured and we showed her dancing prior to that and after that. So they said, use it because that is just what we go through, you know, on an everyday basis. So tell it.
Yeah, that's her experience.
Yeah. And, you know, but I didn't want me being neurotypical. I was overcautious.
Yep.
Well, I don't want to say overcautious. I took it very seriously and wanted to make sure that I didn't fall into that
type of stuff. I get it.
Or right.
Yep.
Yeah.
No, you did well. In my eyes, you did well.
Yeah.
Just like the other doc that I watched this week too. And I was like, okay, this is well done. And I was like, the word proud wouldn't be right because that means I had something to do with it. I was just excited and happy that it was filmed correctly. And that it showed some sides of autism that, you know, people like are maybe scared to see, but there's different versions. People get overstimulated. They may self-harm a little bit. I mean, it happens. My brother does it. I mean, I do it. I mean, it just happens. When I get overwhelmed, shit happens. As I talked about the other day in a lecture, I said, you know, I get deregulated, boy, that's when the police get called. And it ain't happened in a minute, but like, it should get scary when people deregulate, especially if you're autistic. Dan, ain't no way in hell you just straight neurotypical, brother. Just to let you know. I'm not saying you're autistic, but you're a little neurodivergent, bro. You got some stuff.
Oh yeah, I've known that forever.
Yeah. My man twirling around and shit.
No.
Anyone can twirl. I'm joking.
Show me a pirouette. Like, what? Yeah.
What? I just love so many aspects of the movie, but Spencer, any more questions? That was a fantastic one.
Yeah. Just before, you know, I get wrapped up in just doing the interview stuff, I will say that, yeah, I watched the film and I really loved it. There wasn't any moments where I was like, this feels iffy. Like,
yeah.
No. And it didn't feel, it felt like it was actually them living their lives because that's actually what it was, right? Because some of these so-called like reality shows and stuff like that, that speak about like autism and other people with disabilities, it just feels very off-putting and very just like contrived, I guess. I just want to say that, yeah, I really loved your documentary and I hope everybody gets to see it. So,
yeah.
Yeah,
and who knows?
I think we can.
I was gonna say, who knows, Spence? Other people may not see it the way me and you see it because of the differing abilities, and maybe they'll. True. But from our opinion, like it was good and well done. From our opinion, and I don't speak for everyone, right? I just speak for myself.
Well, thank you, and I wanted to make sure, or I tried my best to just be a fly on the wall. You know, those kids were, the parents were paying to take a dance class. The kids were coming to class to put on a recital.
Yeah.
And to learn. I just followed that journey. So I couldn't. Oh, here, this is a funny story if we have time for it. The first day I walked in, again, I'm coming from Columbia Pictures and Simon Cowell, and I have a three camera crew and my sound guy with the boom. And I'm like, let's do this. And the kids come in and they're like on a playground. They're climbing on the camera tripods like they're, they're on the playground and they're sliding under them just being kids. Yeah. You know, they're like, what is this thing here? It's perfect to climb on. They wanted to pet the big caterpillar, which is the boom mic. And within 3 minutes, I like got my entire crew out of there. And I thought, what the fuck were you trying to do, Dan? Who, you know, there's 25 kids in the class and you bring in all this shit and you think they're not going to hang on it?
No,
they're not. Of course they are.
And like we know about autism, all kids, you're going to have your ones that isolate, don't want to even touch you, that are shy. Then you're going to have your other ones that just want to grab on your leg and climb up you, man. It's like, and with autism, well, it's like that, yeah, bro.
I just thought, well, first of all, how stupid am I that I would think that I needed all of that? So I put everyone out in the parking lot and I just told Ben, I said, just and everything changed. I said, sorry, guys, I don't need you until we get to the theater. And we just went to a run and gun, put it on your shoulder. And I would say within 3 weeks, the kids didn't even remember we were there, or they would come over and say hi, and they, you know, Mr. Dan and there's, you know, and Ben, and we were just then part of the class because we just sat in the back and they just got used to us. And Ben knew we just stayed out of the way, just stay out of the way.
Yeah. That's funny. They went in there that first day. Dan's like, we going back to the closet because this ain't working.
Exactly. Well, first to think that I was so grandiose. Well, because when you're a Columbia Pictures, you just make a phone call and another camera shows up. You're like, well, and I didn't have to deal with it. I'd be like, I know, honey. You know, we need, go to soundstage 3. I know it's difficult, but handle it. Bye. And you hang up and then it's done. You know, so after 10 years of that, I'm like, no, Simon wants it. Bye. Click. And now all of a sudden I have to make the decisions. I'm like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
I have no one to call.
Where's Simon? Me. Where is he? Where did he go?
I want to call one of them people and make them handle it.
I'm not going to lie. If I was in there, because I was a little shit, and I was like a lot of behavior modification, a lot of in-school suspension, special ed. If I was to see a camera crew in there, I'm going darting straight at you. I'm probably going to just beat the shit out of you. I'm not going to lie.
Oh, why? Why?
Well, there was
there's a new person here. You're going to die.
There's one camera guy I would appreciate that. So let me see what he's working on.
Let's relive childhood.
Apparently. Yeah, I was not. Any new people.
You're new.
You're at the bottom. I was like, I had a prison mindset even as a kid. We're kicking the shit out of the new kid.
Like, why? What did I do? Nothing. You're new.
My dad was teaching me, you in the yard, they're gonna get it. I was like, okay.
I don't think he meant the schoolyard, but you know, we all live different lives.
We live different lives, bro. You know, hey, I gotta protect what's mine. This is my territory. You know, I was very territorial.
Apparently, jeez.
These are my dogs.
Wild animal. Jesus.
Oh,
this is my
God.
Playground. I'm gonna pee on it.
Remember my sister said on the podcast, my nephew was in the rocker, and then I just speared him right through like a window. And I was like, my God, I was horrible.
Isn't it fun when you look back on times?
I know.
It's real fun.
It's real fun. And like now I'm teaching classes and doing therapy and shit. It's like,
welcome in, new guy. But inside you're like, fucking shut up.
Oh God. I hate when like I see a new client on my appointment books. I'm like, fuck, another new person. And then 5 minutes into talking, I'm like, oh my God, I love this kid. Like, why do I hate? I just hate new people, man.
Only you use that. But hey, you're using it now. That's a good thing. You're using it now as a therapist. Thank God. And instead of on the yard. All right. Well, let's
go to the scenes.
Let's get to the film and the scenes. So, Dan, can you give us what is this documentary about? Like, what are we seeing here?
I'm not even going to. I was going to make a funny joke. I'm not going to. Go ahead, Dan.
Go ahead, Dan.
Well, I follow five kids. It's actually an entire studio, but I feature five kids, and I like to say is I follow them on their journey through life and towards their dance recital. And I was lucky enough to meet Bonnie before she made the announcement that she was going to do a recital. And when we finally got the okay with the parents were okay and the board of directors and, you know, all the parents in the studio had to be okay with it because I would be in the classes. So their kids might be in the background. So it was a big ordeal. And she said, well, I'm going to do a recital. And I went, oh, when are you going to make the announcement? And she said, Saturday. I'm like, oh God. So I had to get my crew together in like 4 days. And we went up there and we open it when she makes the announcement of it. And then I followed them for 10 months until they actually did the recital. So it ends with the actual recital. But as you guys know, I delved into the kid's life and their families because I wanted to, you know, get those stories. That's part of it. So to be able to, you know, be at home with them, have dinner with them, have lunch with them, you know, it's their entire life over 10 months, but it ends with dance, but it's not a dance movie, as you guys know.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. It is and it isn't.
Yeah. It's kind of like it's in the background, really. Like, right. Yes, like you have a goal, like, hey, we're getting to this recital, but it's mainly about these people's, these kids' lives and kind of what they're going through to kind of sift
through.
Well,
to me, it's about the determination, the dedication, the confidence. And what I like is the one scene with Liam on the couch and how he felt he didn't fit in school, but he does at the dance studio. So it's also the community. He found his community, like I found mine in theater. Everybody, you know, you want to fit in somewhere. So he was able to find that. So I think that's a big part of it, because they all feel a part of at the studio.
Yeah.
Totally. I mean, community, that's what I took from it. Community, love, passion. But it's just kids being kids. And, you know, right. Some of them are, I'm sure a lot of them want to dance. Some of them probably don't want to dance, but like they're trying to get them some new experiences. Then they're like, holy shit, this is fun. Because when you're a kid, you don't want to do anything that your parents tell you. It doesn't matter if you're autistic or not. And right. You see them get close to each other and having fun. And one of the scenes that's burned into my mind is that one young girl, I think she's a Latina, and she helped the other girl put her shoes on, her dance shoes. And I was like, that was magnificent. And you just see things like that. You see humanity and you say, you know, it's dance, but it's not dance, but dance is a metaphor for life. This whole movie is just life and the trials and tribulations that everyone goes through. And the recital is just your jobs, your occupations, right? Marriage, relationships. It's just trying to perform and live and survive. It's about surviving, but also having some fun. So, good question, Spence.
First scene that we're doing is so with Bonnie, she has a technique that she uses where, like, you know, where they have to open and close their legs. And so she uses props to really help with that, especially those who have any type of like visual or like audio issues at all. It really helps with that. So I kind of want to know, like, with Bonnie, yeah, I mean, you kind of talked about it already. You kind of got lucky with her. I mean, this is such an amazing way that she does it. And the way that she actually kind of, like, talks and does everything with the students, it's very, like, it's very hands-on, which some people might find that, like, a little uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, obviously, the parents have a lot of trust in her to know that, like, okay, like, she's doing this for a reason. I kind of want to know, like, what was it kind of like kind of seeing how this class works from your point of view?
Well, I actually had a problem not wanting to step in and be the teacher because I was a dance teacher. So right. I was sitting in the back and I'm like, oh, let me just go fix their feet. Let me turn them out. And I'm like, no, Dan, you're not the teacher today. don't do that. But it also made me realize that if you have a good teacher, they're just a good teacher. And she is an amazing teacher because I taught the way my teacher taught me. And when I taught, I always gave options. I would say to the choreography, okay, it's left, right, left. Then I would say it, do it again and show it and say it's 1, 2, 3. I always make noises. I'd go, it's on the ba-da-ba-ba. So she's giving them options like a good teacher would do. She's just expanded that into props and other things that visually help some of these kids. So she takes it very seriously and knows everybody so well that she looks for that entrance point, the way in that will work for them. And I don't think there's any child in the class that doesn't allow her to touch them now, and it is taken time because there are some, you know, some kids that are
sensitivities,
you know, sensory But she has been working with them so much that you saw it. It's the actual scene that she talked about, and she calmed him down.
Yep.
Yeah.
She's able to do that within, what, 5 seconds?
Yep.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and you just think that she's just that angel, that she has developed this system of teaching and this program, and it works.
Yep. The scene, I chose Spence because... What the hell is autism? It's a million fucking things. It's a million things. Mm. And so we're looking at auditory processing issues. So that's getting a verbal command and then it's not computing, right? You know, you're going to, but, right. But there's a pause and there's a speed bump in there. And so with the verbal commands, you'll freeze. And then other humans will give you the verbal command again. And then again, and then again. So now the kid is like, okay, I hear you, but I don't know what to do. Okay, I hear you, but I don't know what to do. And then now you're getting frustrated as the teacher, and now the kid, and angry and hostile, your voice is elevating, your cadence is elevating. Now the kid's feeling the shame and the guilt, the stupidity, the worthlessness, and now they're starting to deregulate and hate themselves. And so that person not being able to modify or understand what the processing issue is only exacerbates what the kid is going through. So her ability to change and use the visual with the scissors, that way they can see it, right, is beneficial and helpful. Does it work for every kid? No. But it's going to help more because the verbal command, now the visual command, you're seeing others do it. You're also practicing it multiple times with their posture and technique. So there's multiple ways to teach someone some things. My father's different. My students are all different when it comes to learning. My brother's different. I can tell my brother a million times. Spencer can tell him a million times when we're going hiking. Okay, you're going to go out with your left foot. And my brother goes up with his right foot. And he's like, what the fuck are you doing? Slim, we're going to take a left. And he goes, I'm like, God damn it. You could teach him a million times how to use that hiking pole when we were on our trip. And then every step is like the first step.
Yeah. Or it'd be like the other time, completely like takes off the backpack, takes off like all the jacket and stuff. And then all of a sudden, just boop, 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 boop. He's like, I've never seen him walk that fast before. He's walking uphill, no problem. He's walking downhill, no problem. It was like me and Nas were just like
shocked,
in awe, very shocked, because we were like, where the hell was this all day?
So we were having some verbal stuff, right? Because I was giving him some commands and he's like getting tired, but then he's overwhelmed and overstimulated, but he's usually not overstimulated. I didn't know he was overstimulated. But then later on, with no backpack, no stick, and it's just him and his clothing, he was in his own world, just trotting. And all the verbal commands now make sense. And we're doing this and that, and he's being funny and lovey-dovey. Like, ain't that some shit? So you learn something, right? I mean, he's 40 years old. He just had his birthday on vacation, and you're learning stuff. And so her ability as a teacher to continuously learn and adapt to each student's individual needs is magnificent. And I think we need to pay attention to this scene for teachers, mentors, parents. To be calm like her, creative like her, is what we need. I get it. You're going to be frustrated. I get it. You told the kid 100 goddamn times to do this one thing. They aren't going to do it. There's reasons why. And it's not because they're being defiant against you or they hate you. There's some other tabulations that are being done in their brains. It just can't compute. There's too many goddamn tabs open in your Google Chrome. 5 of them are frozen. 3 of them are playing music. 1 of them is playing fucking Spider-Man in the background. You know what I mean? You got pop-up ads talking about local people near you. I mean, it's some crazy shit.
Wait a minute. I know those ads. Hold on.
I know those ads. I clicked on it once. That computer no longer works. it's a lot for people with a lot of processing delays and issues. And specificity with each child is important.
Yeah.
And also remember, as the teacher, as the professor, as the lover, caregiver, to have grace for yourself as well, because you're going to feel like a complete idiot at times. You're going to fail. Kids going to throw a tantrum. Maybe they won't understand. You're going to think it's your issue. When I can't get through to a kid when I'm doing therapy, I'm like, I suck. And it's not that you suck. It just needs more time. Be more patient and you'll get through it. I chose that scene because it was good on learning and teaching for both parties.
Yep.
Let's mosey on over to now actually, because that was a good one. I went in depth with that, but let's mosey on over to the juicier scenes.
Yeah. So next one is Liam and his parents talking about autism and kind of learning about what is autism and how does it really kind of change how we parent, I guess. What are some, I would love to know, Dan, like, what are some things you kind of learned? Because, you know, from doing this podcast, I've learned a lot about, and just hanging around Nas in general for the past few years now. It's like, I've learned so much about autism, mental health, and things like that. What are some things that, like, these families kind of really taught you about either just life or just autism or anything, really?
The biggest takeaway would be that halfway through, a switch flipped in my brain. And my entire outlook and perspective had changed. I had gone to Target right before Christmas to do some stocking stuff for gifts. And I had walked by down the aisle and there was a girl on the floor having a tantrum. And I was shopping, I just thought to myself, oh, I wonder if she's on the spectrum. And I just kept shopping. And I got into my car and I started to cry. And I thought, that's it. That's what this movie needs to do. Look what it just did to me. By being with these families and kids for 4 months, and it was only 4 months in, look how my outlook and perspective has completely changed. I didn't think, what a rotten kid. What's wrong with that parent? Why aren't they handling it? Yep. Because I had been educated and been exposed and been around people that I had learned already on my journey. And I thought, I have to make sure the movie does that. So it's being with Liam's parents and going to their house a few times, was that for what works for Liam is constant routine and repetitiveness. So that's why in the film you'll see the signs on the wall, and they change those signs once he gets that behavior accomplished. You know, it's like when we were filming, he wouldn't take his lunchbox out of his backpack. So then the food would be in there, you know, all day and night. And the mom would go, oh, great. Now, you know, we have to throw everything away and blah, blah, blah. So it was like the note was, take your lunchbox out of your backpack and put it in the kitchen. So, and once he had accomplished that, they could then move on to the next thing, whatever that was. And just for them to be so patient. And like I think, Doctor, what you said is in regards to not taking it on as your own problem, you know, you're just, it has nothing to do with you. You're just, you know, working with your child to learn whatever it is they need to learn to move on to the next thing.
Skill.
And I just thought how amazing these parents are and how amazing the kids, you know, it just, we can all learn from everybody and we all see the world through different eyes. And that has nothing to do with a disability or not having a disability. We all see things differently. So why would there be a stigma or something be attached to someone with a disability? Because we all see the world different. So why not learn and experience and go along with the ride through their eyes?
Yeah, people don't have the time or patience. People don't have the empathy. People don't care what your views are, because if you're not progressing this machine or cog of capitalism, if you're not neurotypical, if you're not straight, if you're not, you know, this type of way, you know, professional whiteness, then we throw you away. We throw you behind. They said, I forgot what president it was. He's like, I'll show you a country. And obviously we don't abide by any of this shit anymore. I'll show you a country on how they treat their old and their disabled. And I'll tell you who they are as a country. And we've done a poor job. And other, right, we've done better than some other countries, but we've done a poor job as just as humans. to make sure that we understand what the hell's going on. Look life through their point of view. Maybe they're right and we're wrong. That's what I always like to think about with autism. Maybe we're right. Maybe folks that are fighting for their rights, maybe they're right. And then, you know, you're on the wrong side. Interesting. I picked this scene, Spence, because the dad, the boy was magnificent. Boy was sweet as pie. Different, right? Obviously, they knew something. I wanted to stick on that one real quick with the boy. They said, we knew something was wrong. We knew something was different. Okay, so that's like a trigger word, right? Like, we know that, okay, this kid ain't maybe neurotypical. There's something going on. And I like that because, like, parents, obviously, you know that they're different. Some parents would be like, oh, it's fine. And it is fine. Mm-hmm. But maybe we need to start getting some social workers talking, some therapists, just to check out and see, because maybe there can be some earlier intervention when it comes to speech. Maybe if it's joint mobility issues, maybe it's socializing. We don't want them to be isolated. Maybe they don't fit in. When you see that something's going on, I get it. Yes, we want to accept it. But also, maybe let's do a little check-in first, because there's a lot of kids getting left behind. A lot of kids, there definitely could have been earlier intervention with my crazy ass. But the dad, he goes, I didn't know how to accept it. He's like, I know what it was. I know what's going on. And that's the reaction from a lot of parents, but specifically men. You'll see a lot of men like dip. And by dipped, I mean they'll might even leave the relationship. They might disconnect from the kid. That's not my kid. They'll start to get kind of self-hatey. Why did God do this? Or what was wrong with the mom? Or what's going on? That's a reaction. And that's not necessarily valid. But I can understand, like, they're confused. They're scared. Right. It's different. They got a kid maybe with some disabilities now. So they start to go through this grief and self-hatred, grief of what their kid could be or what they thought it was going to be, look like. The parents will come to my office, Spence, and I've told you before, I would just want my son to be happy. I'm like, your son's happy as shit. Yeah. Well, I want my son to have a normal life. I was like, your son got a normal life. He's in college having fun. He drinks with his friends. Well, I want him to get married. I said he may or may not get married. That's up to him. I don't know what you're looking for, parent. Like, he is happy. Well, I need you to make sure and make him happy. Okay. He is happy. How do you want me to say this again? Do you want me to draw you a diagram of him being happy? Like sunshine? Like, I don't.
Well, it's not the definition. It's not the picture that they had created in their mind.
Correct.
And, you know, that's one of the things that has to
alter.
They have to let relief. They have to release it. But then, and maybe take a while to grieve it. But the reality is, you know, that going back to what you said, our society labels people based on, you know, race, gender, class, sexual orientation. Yep. But those labels then shape expectations in people's minds. And those expectations are set by other people for you. You know, so, and then from that, then now you have a stereotype. Okay, here's the stereotype. Well, that stereotype creates false expectations. You know, so it's like this huge circle. That was a lot of big words. That was a huge circle, but that's what came to my mind. And it's just, you just have to erase all that. Just erase it all. Erase it all and just live in the moment and live with your child, your family.
That's it.
You know?
But it's complicated and I get it. So I like the dad that he said that, because it was a real moment for parents. Not every parent's going to be like, oh, my kid's disabled. Oh, it's fine. No, there's a period. There's a relearning that needs to go on. I like it what the teacher said at the end, or the dance instructor. What was her name again?
Bonnie,
that's right. And she talks about everyone's disabled. Yeah, not everyone's disabled, but I get what she meant. She meant it in a good way.
Yeah.
But everyone's different. Everyone's different, brother. And there's not just one right way to be. Right. And so I appreciated that as well. So I wanted to put some acknowledgement on the parents learning and changing, and also show that this is what good parents do, Spence.
They're also, there's a story with them that I don't think made the movie. I don't think. He felt bad on a different level, that they then had to overcome, because he had to work two jobs to pay for everything until everything worked out. You know, you can apply for government aid and you're applying here and for school and all this stuff. Well, it could take years, you know, there's such a backlog and, you know, everything is so fucked up in that world.
Yeah.
You know, nobody, like you said, they just, you know, nobody pays attention. They just toss it aside, whatever will, you know. So he was working two jobs. So he would get home and he would miss everything. So he would then read what was on the wall, like take your lunch out of your backpack. Well, then his wife would say, oh, no, we accomplished that yesterday.
Mm.
So he was like, I missed like a week of my son's life. Yeah. Wait, what the fuck just happened? But he had to do what he needed to do for them to survive and to pay for what they needed, because the government was lax and not paying attention. So then he felt guilty about that.
Yep.
You know, so then that there's that part that you just think, you know, we not walking in someone else's shoes, but then he's got then dad has that guilt. I'm not around my kids enough because I need to work to help my family survive.
Life is complicated, man. Yeah. And you want to talk about stress? That's some stress there. You working two jobs now and then you're also missing out on some stuff. It's a lot to just think about. It's a lot to do. And I'm always so fucking tired. I can't imagine having a kid working multiple jobs too. And then just, you know, it's just a lot, man. Shout out to all the parents with kids. Shout out to the parents, you know, living and loving kids with differing abilities. Shout out to all the caregivers, grandma stepping in, grandpa stepping in. Shout out to everyone. Yeah. It was another good scene. We keep it moving. What is this one? I got it down as scene 3. That says, oh, this is the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I think when Bonnie is trying to do something, I cannot read my handwriting. God damn.
The scene should be when Bonnie's like kind of talking about autism. And I think that's the one where we kind of covered a little bit too on it. It's about how everybody with autism is different.
Yes.
It's just that it shows up differently in everybody else. Which, hey, I mean, we've talked about that plenty of times where, you know, we talk about how most people are on the spectrum. It's just that doesn't show as much.
Yep.
It's just, you're on the opposite end of the spectrum. That's just how it goes. I mean, I think it really rings true is that, and then I also want to say that we also kind of do have to get a little bit more empathy. And I love that this film kind of shows that, and gives us a nice perspective. And, you know, I think with other documentaries as well, I'm not a huge fan of some documentarians jumping in and using their voice to kind of talk about it.
Yeah.
Because I want the people that are living in the moment that have to live with this every day to speak with it. And I really love that about this documentary is the fact that, all these people get to have their own perspective and we get to really see it and hear it, through, you know, how they talk about like their everyday lives. So,
I had chosen that scene because she's you know, articulating some good stuff. And I'm not sure if we talked about it a lot. I think we did. Yeah. You know, one kid on the spectrum, you know, one kid. You got some kids that are savants. You got other kids that have severe learning and intellectual processing disabilities. But a lot of us are in the middle. And it's the ones that are in the middle, right, that are not getting diagnosed. It's the women that we know right now that are not getting diagnosed because of the quote unquote, less severe issues or symptoms, right? The less overt symptomologies, we would call it. So we would label them in older terms, because me and Dan technically talked about this. You know, I don't want to get in trouble for using the wrong words. But it used to be called like high functioning, or it used to call it like Asperger's, which we don't use anymore, right? Because it's an old school Nazi term. And so what we call that is low support needs. They don't need a lot of support. Like me and Spence, right? We're just doing fine. Well, I used to need some support, but we're doing fine, right? Pretty much autonomous. And then you got other folks that are high needs, high support, stimming, self-harm, right? The different behaviors that we're like, okay, they need some help. And it's interesting because folks, we'll get into the next scene. It's like, they call my son Rain Man. And so that's what people think is it's that kid just stimming. It's that kid hitting his head. And what you see a little bit in this show, right? You're seeing some of those aspects of autism when there's some stimulation stuff. Maybe they're processing. Maybe they're excited. Who fucking knows? Right. It's such a diaspora of what autism is. And that's why I wanted to pick that out. She's also touching on a lot of different things like sensory-related stuff, sound, texture. That's when she's talking about clothing. She's like, well, now that I told you about clothing, I bet you can all feel your clothing. Now imagine fucking always dealing with that. I was doing a talk at work because we finally talked about autism at work, Spencer, for diversity. We ain't talked about any disability stuff in 4 years since I've been there. It's all race, sexuality. I get it. That's a big topic. But holy shit, there's a million other diverse things that are out there. And we deal with such high rates of autism at Purdue University because it's a very STEM-oriented, science-oriented university. And one of my coworkers brought it up, and she said there was pushback, Spence. She said that they didn't know how this applied to the university talking about autism. I was like, are you fucking kidding me? When she told me that, I didn't really fully process it. I got angrier throughout the day. I was like, those ableist motherfuckers. And so we did the talk and the teaching, and I'm talking about why it matters. Because it's this invisible thing, right? This autism for a lot of folks that are on college campuses. And I'm talking about, they were like, well, we don't know how to help or support in our offices. So I start breaking down how you could and start calling people out in a good way. I said, homie over there, I walk into your office. I feel like I'm being fucking suffocated by the candle that you have in there. You know, if you have some students that you think that are neurodivergent, maybe you could put that out before they get in there because it is literally choking me. I said, my homie here, I love you, man. And when I make comments, like as soon as I walk in, I'm like, oh, someone did laundry today. I say that because it's so potent and it's also suffocating. I'm like, bro, back off on the beads because it is fucking terrible in here. One of my coworkers, bright as hell in her office. And I'm like, y'all can dim the lights or, you know, some of y'all be cooking and like warming up fucking fish and then seeing your client at 1 o'clock. Like, what are we doing here? What are we doing? It sounds like a fucking dirty diaper in here. Like, it's just like, and so I get overstimulated in some people's offices, and mine's got a lot of gadgets and toys, but the lights are pretty dim, very chill, very homey. I'm not sitting directly in front of the fucking kid either, where like they force you to make eye contact. I'm like, oh my God, are we dating now? Like, this is fucking intense.
Look at me in the eyes.
Yeah. They're like rubbing
your traumas.
It's like knee to knee. And I'm like, get the fuck off of me. And so I'm talking about autism, all these differing things. And I said, some kids won't have any of these issues, but for me, I do. And so I think when we watch things like this, when we see scenes like this, when we think about differing of sensories and abilities and intelligence and intellect, it makes us actually slow the hell down for a few minutes and look at each person as a person. Real quick, Dan, I don't know if you want to talk about this or not, or if you're cool with it, but earlier we were talking about, I think it's a good point to make. We were talking about like, hey man, I'm sorry if I messed something up. The nomenclature and the verbiage that we use has changed so much over time. And, you know, I wish people could just be more patient. I don't know if you wanted to talk on that. If not, me and Spencer can talk on it real quick.
No, I don't mind talking about it. I think because I'm gay and I'm in a community that, you know, the LGBTQIA community, I can relate in regards to titles and names and things like that. And I always am very conscious of what to say. And whenever I've done an interview, I've even asked the people if they are in the disabled community, you know, how do you want to be recognized? Because there's a fight in the disability community. Some want the identity first, some want their name first. Okay, that's absolutely fine. But when we first meet, I don't know that yet. It's just like you wanting to know my pronouns. You don't know that until we discuss it. you know, I don't, I go by he, him, but I'm not offended by, you know, they, them, whatever, you know, like I said, I call everybody booby, you know, because it's easier and I'm just waiting for someone to say, no, that is an insult that you call me booby. So
I like your boobies. Sorry.
Oh my God.
you got,
there it is.
You got some there boobies. It is. Hey, is that a wig down there?
That's what we like to call a callback.
Yeah, exactly. But I'm Tom. That's a good comedian. Ties it in.
Yeah, that's what we call around. Autism. So
yeah,
he's been waiting for that.
You know, so
continue.
We have to have the conversation ahead of time before you can remind me if I said it wrong. You know, something that I've just noticed in the last couple weeks is that. I'm seeing discussions online that people with autism don't mind being called autistic. Well, a couple of years ago, that was not accepted, and there was a fight to not call them that. Well, now they're like, but no, my name is Ben, and I'm autistic. Okay, you can say it, but can I say it? You know, again, it you know, there's so many, everybody has their own preference, and as long as we are open to learning and to having the discussion and having the patience to listen to each other about it and be respectable enough to discuss it and to ask the questions, you know, and then we can just grow from there instead of, you know, I see a lot of times people get insulted right away if you don't
nail it.
Yeah. Well, I just met you. So we didn't discuss they, them. We didn't discuss he, him, she, her, autistic or with autism, or, you know, we haven't discussed it yet. So let's just have the conversation first before tempers rise up. So that's always my concern. And I've always asked people, because once it's taped like this conversation, I have no control over it. You do, you know? And I just to be respectful of everyone, and it has nothing to do with my film, the community. It has to do with the world. And just be respectful of everybody, and we'll move forward fine.
Yeah, I'll kick it to Spence here in 2 seconds to get your opinion too, because people mess up, and I think that we judge people so immediately and be like, "Oh, you said it wrong. You're like terrible, or this or that." I'm like, damn, dude, like, I mean, there's so many different ways to say things when it comes to autism, disabilities. And I'm like, I just say, yeah, because you're not supposed to label a client like that's your autistic client. But I'm like, but then you're not also supposed to say, well, that's Jennifer who has autism. You're just supposed to say Jennifer is autistic. And so it gets convoluted sometimes. I'm also like, where's the patience? Where's the patience in some of these things? And then we all have different preferences. So I've been attacked on our post when I type up some things and be like, oh, you should word it like this. And then someone else is going to be like, well, you should word it like this. I'm like, so everyone's fucking mad. Everyone's always mad, and I can't make everyone happy. And so me and Spencer, it's always in good faith, we do our best. And I feel like as Americans, we no longer believe that people are doing things in good faith. That we always feel like they're doing it with some maliciousness, and most folks are not. And I get it, being the oppressed individual, me, Spencer, you, Dan. It's easy to fall into that and to like lash out. And I get that we've been objectified and like oppressed in different ways. I get it. But also, how do we build bridges if we're always like lashing out? And so I'm looking for patience on both sides. And I get we're always telling oppressed folks to have more patience, but this is things around nomenclature that changes so fucking much. It changes so much. I just wanted to touch on that. I wasn't trying to put you on the spot. I know me and Spence fall into some stuff because social media is like a death trap. It is what it is. Spence, I know you got
fun with it.
Yeah.
I mean, I have fun with it on the social media part. Like, you know. I just, somebody says something stupid, I just call them stupid. Like, you know, I mean, if you say something like really dumb, especially about like autism or anything like that, or like political issues, I'm just like, get the fuck out of here.
Get out of here.
Like, shut up. I agree with what both of you are saying. I also think that we get a little too stuck on like our identities. Like, yes, that is a big part of us, but that doesn't make all of us, right? Like we say on here, it's everyone's different, right? So if we say autistic, you know, depending on who you are, you're going to have a viewpoint of that in some way or the other, right? And so you say like, oh, I'm autistic, someone else is going to be feeling some certain way about it, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone's going to be different, and you can't really change that about other people except for trying to educate them in a certain way. And that's what we're doing here on this podcast, is trying to educate people and telling people, yes, we're autistic, and that means a lot of different things. Bingo. It doesn't mean just one, right? And so and so did Bonnie also said that in the documentary as well. I just want to point that out. But I think that sometimes we get so caught up in our identities, and yes, those do play a huge part in our lives depending on who you are, but that doesn't really define exactly who you are either, right? There are people all over the world that are different, even though they are of the same race, the same, yep, whatever, able body, disability body, everything. And so I just think that sometimes we need to kind of, like everyone said, have patience. But then also we also need to have some type of, you know, take a look at ourselves and just be like, okay, that just because they said that doesn't make it true about me. I have to go on and try to move forward with my life, because, you know, and yes, we've also talked about how the negative thoughts can sometimes outweigh the positive ones, mm-hmm, a lot of the times. But I think that we just kind of have to let things kind of roll off our backs and just keep on going, or else we're just going to get stuck in the stereotypes that people give us. I mean, who would have thought, you know, me, Salim, Naz would be going on a camping road trip throughout the Midwest and all that. Like,
yeah,
you wouldn't think that when you, like,
you wouldn't think three autistic people could make it, you know, but we did.
No, we almost died.
Yeah, three,
we
almost died. Three city boys. We literally autistically yelled at city boy,
city boy.
And people were like, what the fuck? Even the bears were like, we're not eating them, we might get autism. Jesus.
I can't look at my other bears in the eye.
No. Like, yeah, what? The one bear's like, that one had the flu shot. Oh
my God. Bears was like, I want some chicken tenders. What the fuck? What? What's happening? What's here?
That Mexican one tastes like on? Beans.
Oh,
I'm done. I'm sorry.
All right. But yeah, I just think that, you know, we need to have a little bit more time with the other people that might be saying certain things, but then we, yep, also have to have a little bit more time with ourselves and just say like, okay, this is not who I am. I'm more than what they give me. Correct. And let's not get stuck in those labels. So
there you go. Yeah. Technically the next scene, we're actually going to kind of mosey past. I wanted to point it out with the young black woman, and she was like a savant, and she was really good with the pitch and different things like that. And she had some issues with like taking the commands or doing what the parents did. And that could be a whole host of reasons. It could be some processing issues. It could be PDA, which we did a podcast on pathological demand avoidance and how a kid deregulates when they get a command, and for many different reasons. But I wanted to stick on that because the mom talked about her kid getting called Rain Man, and the right, that's kind of derogatory. And she felt like it was a slur towards her kid. And so that's one thing, which a lot of people get, they legit will get slurred like that. But she said this one word, compendium, or what me and Spencer talked about, this omnibus of like comics. And so when you're like, oh, well, I've got that. You listen to this podcast, you're like, I do that, that, and that. So maybe I'm autistic. Well, doing two things, it doesn't make you autistic. It's the addition of all of these things. It's vast, the context that you have to add up, and you're like, okay, this is probably autism. When I'm making diagnosis in the office or referring out for formal assessments, I'm looking at so many different things, Spencer. I'm looking at generational backgrounds, like parents, siblings. I'm looking at grandparents, aunties. I'm looking at mental health related issues, and I'm looking like all of them, like a million of them, to see which ones you got. Processing stuff, learning stuff, social skills, interpersonal skills, what's your self-talk, hyperphantasia, which we did a podcast on. There's a million different things that we did a podcast on, which I'm assessing for. And when you add all those up and it's like, holy shit, kid, you highlighted like 90% of the sheet. You're probably autistic. Let's be real. The chances that you're a normie, slim to none. You're not a normie kid, you know. You got a backpack full of chicken tenders that you haven't emptied out in 2 weeks, you know. Did your parents take your sign off? I don't know. That's what we call a throwback. Sorry. I'm not making fun of that kid. I am making fun of myself because I literally will leave the food in my backpack when I get home from work and it'll be like Monday. And I'm like, God damn, it smells like shit in here.
Yeah, I've done that a few times myself.
Yeah.
It's just leftover food. I'm just like, shit.
It's so hard for me to take the stuff out of my lunchbox I still have a lunchbox. When you're a working man, you get a lunch pail. Yeah, a lunch purse.
A lunch purse. It's a pail. It's a lunch pail.
It's a lunch bag.
A bag, or do you have like Wonder Woman on a metal container, like when you were in school?
Yeah. Well, we were poor, so we didn't. Maybe we didn't get that.
Never mind. I had Wonder Woman. Sorry.
Yeah. Oh.
Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. That's you, Cleveland folks, with all your money and shit. Yeah, yeah. I had like one taquito. I had like a taquito.
Yeah, Cleveland's very high paying over there.
I know, I'm joking. FYI.
Matching thermos. I'm sorry.
Matching thermos.
God, don't imagine.
FYI, fuck Ohio. So.
Oh, here we go.
Michigan. So I just want to touch on those couple of things because I want to get more of his input on something. We talked about. Actually, on the time when we're looking at, we might actually move on down to the last scene. I want to spend some time on this. I want to get Dan's thoughts and what's going on with this because you talked about it in pre-production. So, Sara, Spence, you want to explain kind of what happened and then let's pivot right to Dan and get his thoughts and opinions. And then there was some background stuff with Sara, too, that you said that was very well worth talking about.
Yeah. So, with Sara, she has this disease that kind of affects like her whole body movement, but especially in her ankles. And so it's very hard for her to kind of walk around and things like that, or to do like certain movements without falling. And then we see that she actually got hurt falling. And so we're in their living room with Sara and her parents and her brother. And we see the parents kind of going through just kind of how Sara grew up and how she was treated as a kid with somebody with a disability. And it's very it's very sad because like Dan was saying before, she's a very sweet and very happy, loving person. And to see somebody like that really get bullied and teased and, you know, all this other stuff because they're different. Really sucks, honestly. Yeah. It just really sucks. A lot of kids, you know, kids and adults are just assholes.
They suck.
Yeah. Humans. They suck.
Humans. We don't need them.
So I forgot if this was just in the pre-production, but Dan, do you mind kind of going, like, what was it like filming with Sara and what was it like kind of having her parents open up and kind of delve a little bit deeper into who she is as a person?
Well, as I was filming her in the dance studio, first of all, she couldn't walk by herself at all.
I know.
And the ballet, the classes gave her the strength to do that. So that is a kudos. You know, if she's got a long walk, she's got, you know, the crutches to use. But that was one of the highlights of the recital, is she was able to dance without crutches in part of it. But she is just this ball of sunshine and happy and smiling. And when she would walk into the dance studio, all the little kids ran over to hug. Everybody needed a hug from Sara because they just loved her, and she radiated that. So I knew that there had to be a deeper story behind that somewhere. So I just paid attention and watched her in class and would talk to her after and talk to her mom, but she just always smiled and was always happy and always positive. So the film director in me and the Phil Donahue in me, your audience won't understand that, but you get it. I needed to find more out about her. So we then set up a meeting at her house. And that was actually, I think the one that is in the film is the second time I went there. And I was able to get them to feel comfortable enough to share the story of her being bullied in school. And I think that because of what she went through in her life, she doesn't want to hurt anybody else. She doesn't want to bully. She's not a bully at all. So she was maybe slightly overcompensating, and she gives everybody love because she was picked on in school. And to see her mom and dad become so vulnerable and talk about it and share what they witnessed, and I think that's part of the reason that they did it. It was also, therapeutic for them. I mean, how often they never talked to Sara about it before, how often does a parent get to talk to you? You don't want to tell your daughter, oh my God, we felt so sorry for you at school today. When do you have the time to do that? Mm-hmm. But she's older now. So for them to open up and share that side, so that I'm hoping that people in the movie who watch the movie, first of all, will think twice if they see someone who is trying to walk with crutches and carry their lunch tray, that maybe you can just say, can I help you in any way? If they say no, fine, but mission accomplished. If they're close to a seat, move over one, let them sit there. There's so many simple things we can do in society that when we're not involved so much in ourselves and we yep. open up and look out, we can then see these things. So just, be aware of stuff like that. And I think that's why they wanted to finally share it. So hopefully people will learn a simple lesson like that. And also, maybe some asshole won't bully some kid.
Come on, bro. I mean, you see she can't walk, and then you decide to cover up the spots so she got to work further? That's a special type of kid. I mean, I was a shit. I wasn't doing that. I was a shit. I wasn't doing that. That's demonic. And I just think about her, and I think about, my father. It was disabled, and I probably didn't really acknowledge or see things as much through a disabled body. And now, like, when people are struggling, like, or like folks are struggling carrying groceries to their car, I'm like, hey, man, I'm gonna go help you. I know I'm big and I'm scary, and you're probably gonna think I'm gonna rob you, but like, legit, let me help you put your shit in your car. Let me open up this door. Let me inconvenience myself 1% to help this person out 10%, 20%. Let me bring something good into the world instead of just being so focused on me all the time. And I find myself like calling things out. It's hilarious. Like, I'll be walking with Spence. I'm like, watch out for that bump. And he's like, what the fuck are you telling me for? Well, like, why? Cause I'm so used to walking with my dad, like, hey, there's a step there, watch it. And you just start to see things in a different way. And, I don't know. I just loved her. She got me to cry pretty good. Because of her pain, as I said. And I know a lot of people probably cried at the end because the dance recital is magnificent. The parents are sobbing. Her dad did the same type of cry where it was just like a deep pain cry.
I made the film and I've watched it 150 times in editing. And every time it gets to that scene, I'm bawling.
Yep.
Every time. Just last week when I watched it again, for conversations like this.
Yep.
And I'm like, son of a bitch. And yep. then here comes that. And I know it's coming.
You're like, damn, I filmed that well.
Yeah. This so good.
Oh, it hurts.
This a fucking Emmy right here, bro.
It's me.
Bro, it's just, as I said, when I have clients that cry in my office, and they cry all the time. Everyone does. It doesn't matter what gender, size. I love when my big boys cry because they don't never cry in front of anyone. Then they cry in front of me and the floodgates open. And you get used to that. You get desensitized to the big criers. It's the ones that hold it like her that face is kind of moving, articulating different. It's my autistic kids that express in a different way. So maybe they actually can't cry, but you can feel it. A couple of my clients, their eyes just get real red and they hold their breath, and that shit destroys me. Because you know they're in pain. And then I think about, I'm probably one of the few people on this earth that knows how much pain they're in. I can see it. Where other people are like, oh, they're fine. They're not, there's no tears. I'm like, nah, bro, this is bad. So her pain was tough there. And it was real for millions of others in the world. And so as an autistic individual, I feel that and it hurts. And then I got angry because when I love something or care about something, I get protective. And when I get protective and then you hurt something that I love, well, now I get very angry. And when I get angry, I get violent. And when I can't do anything with my violence, then I cry. That's how it works in my brain. Step by step by step by step, all the way to breakdown. It took me a while to figure out what that breakdown was. It was a good scene. And I think a lot of parents will identify with it. And I told Spence, I'm like, bro, we get some kids, bro. I don't know. We about to go crazy, bro.
What's about to happen?
You know, something about to happen. Money?
What?
We about,
what?
Well, you might have some kids. I'm going to adopt like 10 kids. You know.
I want that one.
I want the third. What, Dan, what'd you say? You were the third one from the left?
Third one from the left.
That's
there you
the,
go. Now you that, know.
That's the big-headed white kid. Okay, now I know.
Now you know the second on the right. She's like, God damn.
Second on the right.
You have to change my spot next time.
Man, that's another Mexican kid. I didn't want that kid. Oh, my God. I can say that.
Yes, you can say.
I can say that. Spence, what were you thinking about just in general? And then as you know, as we transition to capping off the film.
Yeah. I mean, just kind of what I was saying before. It's just that I'm glad that she is still a very kind-hearted person.
Preach.
And that the people who have been assholes in her life have not changed her to be an asshole. And so I think that's a great thing to also point out, because a lot of the times, a lot of people who don't have like a support system, people who are there for them, they turn into kind of like hermits or shells of themselves, because they want to hide everything that kind of made them. And it's very sad to see, especially people who feel like they can't express themselves or just, you know, live with the disabled bodies that they were born with. I'm glad that Sara,
talks about that social exclusion, that social anxiety, that social just condemnation of who she is and what her body is. And she talks, and you see it on her face. Yeah. Good. I forgot to bring that up. Good. I'm glad you brought that up.
So, all right. Yeah. I think, are we wrapped up here?
Yeah, Dan.
All right. Yeah, Dan. Any plugs that you got for us today before we get out of here?
No, just this. And I'm excited. I'm glad that we're doing this interview in July, because it's Disability Pride Month. And the movie is free on Amazon Prime in support of that. And it looks like they're going to extend it through August.
Nice.
So, you know, baby steps like that help, you know, raise awareness. I think one thing I hope that maybe people can take away from this conversation or from the movie is that we as a community have the chance to raise awareness and the chance to work together to remove obstacles. You know, every day we have the opportunity to work towards inclusion for all.
Reach.
And our goal should be to build a community, build a world that is committed to creating a space where everybody can do well and succeed. Wake up tomorrow and just think of that. Think of, we have the ability. We have the ability right now, as soon as we hang up from this, to make a change. You know, so just just be aware of it. And just, you know, the things that some of us take for granted, ramps, whatever it is, you know, for people with wheelchairs or with crutches or holding the door when you go to Target because there's a lady behind you. We can hold the door for anybody. Why does it matter? You know, yeah. And just be more inclusive and empathetic and build towards a community or a country or a world that works together where everyone can succeed.
Preach. Yeah. I can't say it better. Preach. Love that.
There you go. All right, everybody. Thank you so much, Dan, for coming on to the show. Dan Watt, please go check out Everybody Dance on Apple TV, iTunes, and it's free on Amazon Prime. So go check it out there while it's on there. Yeah. Oh, thank you so much. Oh, yeah. Go ahead.
You know what? The distributor put it on his YouTube channel for free also. You don't have to subscribe. So okay. Type in Everybody Dance documentary on YouTube, and at least through August, it's also free on YouTube.
Okay. And go. That'll be plugged down below. Yep. Sorry, Spencer. Yep. That'll be plugged down below. It'll be in the posts. So we'll be able to promote as much as we can.
Awesome. Cool. Well, there we go. Thank you so much, Dan, for coming on. We'd love to have you back on again for any movie, whether it's yours or just one that's kind of popped up for you. Been great getting to know you. So, yeah, with that, I'm Spencer. That's Nas, Different Spectrum Podcast.
All right, everyone. Much love, much respect. Thank you for listening to this. This was a wonderful topic. And remember, take care of yourselves.
Or don't.
It's completely up to you. Peace.